So hello everyone, welcome to the first session on competitive learning conducted by the Webben Coding Club of IIT Bombay. So today we have with us a very special person with us, Shubham Jain. He is a fourth year undergraduate in the electrical department of IIT Bombay, and he is also known to be one of the best competitive programmers in the institute. So to give a background, Shubham Jain qualified for the world finals in the competition known as ACM-ICPC, which is the toughest competition in competitive programming that is conducted worldwide for all college students. So in this session, we will start by giving you an introduction to competitive programming, and Shubham Jain will tell you how to proceed and what he has done to reach the level that he has. And after that, so this is the first event that we have for you in regarding competitive programming. And after that, we'll have a contest for freshies as well as senior students for in the next weekend. And we'll also release resources for all of you to prepare so that you can learn this field and also have a lot of fun in this entire process. So I would like to hand over the mic to Shubham Jain, and he can guide all of you and tell you how he began with competitive programming. So Shubham Jain, please, you can speak. Yeah.
Hello. Yeah, just a second. Let me share my screen.
Yeah, sure.
All right. That's visible, right?
Yeah, it's visible. Ronald, nothing has started. We are just beginning now. Yeah. Okay, I will mute myself now. Shubham, if you need any help, just let me know. And yeah, guys, sure. If you have questions, sure, raise your hands and I think you can unmute you. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, hello everyone. So today I'll be talking about competitive programming 101, which is basically an introduction to competitive programming. So this will be relevant for you if you haven't like explored much and you're looking to, you know, start CP. Irregardless of whether you know or do not know programming before. So let's get into it. So the structure of the talk I'm thinking of is this. I'll have breaks every few slides. And like you can ask questions then by unmuting yourself, but you can like feel free to keep asking questions in chat, and I answer them at these breaks. We have some actual competitive programming problems sprinkled throughout this whole presentation. So we'll solve some problems as well. And you can post your answers in the chat, like whenever that comes up. And you don't need to take any notes because we'll share this presentation with you later. So all of the links and the sites and everything, you'll get it. So yeah. Okay. And just a disclaimer that some of these like opinions are personal, so they don't reflect anybody else's opinion. All right. So the first thing to understand is what is competitive programming. So there is some Wikipedia definition here that it's a mind sport and it involves participants trying to program according to some provided specifications. But that's the important part. What are these specifications? So if I tell you in a nutshell, it's basically creative problem solving using data structures and algorithms as tools. And it's quite similar to solving like mathematical puzzles, which I'm sure that many of you would have done as kids. So the idea is that you're given some problem statement and participants write code which solves this problem. And the code must obey some strict time and memory limits over a number of test cases to get an accepted verdict. And roughly like I would divide competitive programming into two parts. The first is the actual logic and mathematical part, where you come up with the solution. And the second part is where you write the code to implement your solution. So you will understand more about this as we do some problems. All right, so I'm not going to do this problem, but this is just for you guys to understand how a competitive programming problem looks like. So usually you have a statement which like tells you what the problem is. Then you have an input format which tells you in what format the input is given to you. So for example, here you have NNK, two integers separated by a single space, and then some integers in the second line. And it tells you the output format as well. And then there are some examples for you to test your code on. And then there is a like some explanation or something of the test case. All right, so that is roughly how competitive programming problems look on every side. The constraints are either given in the input or separately in a constraint section. All right, so let's try a problem first. So if any of you get it, you can like post in the chat. The question is that you're given some Fibonacci number So output three Fibonacci numbers which sum to this number. And here is a refresher for you. The recurrence for Fibonacci is fn equal to fn minus 1 plus fn minus 2. So like, let me just check. Did anyone get the idea already? Yeah, Sanchit, you can speak. You can unmute yourself at these times.
Something like that, fn minus 1 plus fn minus 3 plus fn minus 4.
Yeah,
breaking
right.
N minus 2 further.
Yeah, that's right, Sanchit. So the idea over here is that you can break one of these into two more Fibonacci numbers. The only thing you have to notice that there might be some edge cases, such as, you know, if like you're given the input 1, then it might not be possible. So you need to take care of those cases. That's it. So the idea of Sanchit was right. I'm just splitting it another way. So you can try it yourself later. This is an actual problem. So you guys can go and code it later. All right. I'm giving you another problem and you can think about it. We'll go through some other slides and then I'll give you the solution later. So I assume that all of you know what a matrix is. Say that you're given a matrix of size n cross m. And a matrix is called good if no two adjacent cells contain the same value, where adjacency is defined as if the cells, if they share a side, the cells are adjacent. So you're given some matrix A, you want to convert it into a good matrix. And what moves are you allowed to use in the conversion? You're either allowed to keep the cell the same or increase the value by one. So is the question clear? Like, I can leave this. Okay, question is not clear. Okay, so the question is that you're given some matrix of size n cross m, and this matrix basically has some numbers filled in it. So you can do some moves on this matrix, and in each move, you can change the value of a cell by either you can increase it by one or keep it the same. And you can't change like the same cell multiple times. So can you convert this matrix to a good matrix such that no two adjacent cells contain the same value? All right. So I'll move on to the presentation and you guys can think about this question and we'll come back to the solution. And if anyone has it, then at that time they can unmute themselves. All right. So why should you do competitive programming? Basically, competitive programming helps you to master data structures and algorithms, which is like a crucial topic in computer science. And it will help you in your future programming projects, etc. Like it's kind of the basic building block on which the rest of your programming rests. So a big advantage that I found was that it reduces the amount of time you take to go from, you know, this is what I should do in the code, to actually writing a fully working code that gives you the correct answer. You get used to the type of logical thinking that you require to write complicated programs. So for example, what happens is that when I was a beginner, this happened to me, and I'm sure that it happens to some of you as well. When you're starting to write a program, then you can't really anticipate what you're going to need to change later. And then what happens is that you sometimes go back and start rewriting your code to kind of be consistent with what you're writing later. So when you do a lot of competitive programming, you kind of get like, you kind of start predicting that, you know, this is what I'm going to do. So you like start writing code faster and you don't have to, you know, retype stuff. So that is a really helpful skill. You learn to debug your code and others' code very quickly. Why your code? Because, you know, even if you get the correct idea for a problem, until your code is completely bug-free, it will not get accepted. So you will learn to debug your code very quickly. And this is like a great skill because it's very useful. Oftentimes, debugging code takes more time than actually writing the code. So, you know, once you have this skill, it's going to help you a lot in all your programming projects. And others' code. Why do I say others' codes? Because there is, for example, in contests, there is this hacking system where you can earn points by making others' program give the wrong answer on some specific test case. So to earn points, you'll start you will start noticing, you know, what are the common mistakes that people make and where this program could go wrong, and start writing test cases for that. So you will learn to debug people's code very quickly. It will be much easier for you to write smaller programs and try to build your own large system from scratch. So I'm sure that people have told you that, you know, in your resume projects and stuff look good. But especially if you're just starting with C++ and you don't know a lot of it, it will be hard for you to kind of envision the scale of a project. And sometimes you end up overestimating, underestimating your ability. You aren't sure to what level you can write code and stuff like that. So competitive programming is a much easier way to start with that. It gives you a set definition, you know, that you have to solve this problem, and you will basically have like a single file code, not like, you know, hundreds of files or what, tens of files, whatever. So it's much easier to start with it at the beginning, and then you'll get, as you get used to it, you can start building large systems as well as projects. It's a fun way to get comfortable in various programming languages. So for example, you know, if you know C++ and Python, what you can do is just take up a competitive programming problem. You're trying to learn, like, say, PHP. Then you solve the problem, then you code it in PHP and then submit it. So it helps you understand what the syntax of PHP is, how to take input, output, and sorting, and basic algorithms. So, yeah, it's a good way to get comfortable. And, there is this thing that people, like, find nice, that you can participate and win a lot of swags, just t-shirts, bags, electronics, and cash from various competitions that keep happening. So that's just a side benefit. The most important benefit, I think, to people is that it makes you a very desirable candidate to most companies. So, yeah, I don't know if this is like fair or not, but competitive programming problems are very often used as hiring tools in interviews or placement tests. So what ends up happening is that people who do competitive programming do tend to get an edge, and therefore, I think, you know, many seniors even tell you that you should do competitive programming. Yeah, I think that it's true up to an extent, and it definitely did help me in my own interview. So even though I hadn't done like courses like operating systems or something, due to like doing very well on the programming part, I got the offer. And most importantly, because it's a very fun sport, you'll get used to the adrenaline rush of, you know, solving things 1 minute with 1 minute to go on the timer and getting that green accepted and stuff like that. It can become very addictive, and it can potentially become a lifelong hobby. Just like people play chess or anything, it's just like a mind sport. So, yeah, let's come back to this question and let me see if anybody has the solution, and then we'll take questions. Does anybody have the solution to this problem?
Hello? Hello, hello, hello.
Yeah, hi.
Hello?
Yeah, I can hear you. Yeah.
So I am saying that we can simply do a trick like that. If I plus j is even, then we check the number on that square. And if it is even, we will leave it as it is. And if I plus j is odd, and if we check the number, if it is odd, then we leave it as it. Okay.
Yeah.
But if I plus j is even and the number is odd, then we add plus one to it. Same applies for the...
What's your name, by the way?
My name is Hanan. Hanan Bashir.
Okay, Hanan. Thanks a lot. So that is the correct answer. Okay. So, yeah.
So sure.
The idea is that you look at the matrix as a chessboard, and with white being an odd number and black being an even number. So, you know, if odd numbers and even numbers are placed next to each other, then they can never be equal, right? So what we can do is we can force like every alternate number to be odd and every alternate number to be even. And of course, to convert every value to an odd or even number, we'll require to add at most one with regards to what we want to convert it to. So yeah, actually, like, it was a relatively hard problem, meaning it was like rated around 1600 to 1700. So yeah, these are the kind of problems that you can expect. I'm giving these to you because I like these problems. They don't require a lot of knowledge, but they require some creativity. All right. So I think I can take other questions now. How often does one face problems similar to CPL writing software? I don't think that, as Pradeepta said, it's not like a lot of overlap. But sometimes it does help you kind of understand the solution or reduce the complexity. So, for example, there was this problem in my internship that I was trying to solve, and due to my competitive programming background, I was able to come up with like an efficient solution for it, and it would be hard without it, I think. But the most important thing is that it helps you get to that level of, you know, being able to write quickly and getting out your code quickly so that you know what needs to be done. So I wouldn't say that it's very helpful, but from what I have read somewhere, I won't give stats on this, and this is my own opinion. The, you know, decent software is there, you know, around 1600 code forces or something. So I would say you aim for that, and that is where you should be roughly if you want to become a software engineer. Or that is where you should aim to be, basically. So Pranava asks, does competitive programming help in building skills relevant to electrical engineers? Is there any overlap of area in the types of problem solved? Well, I think it could be relevant if you're doing embedded C, for example. So if you're an embedded systems programmer, then it could be helpful for you. I'm not sure, Pranava, but if you have done like courses like microprocessors or something. So there, I think coming up with efficient algorithms could be useful. I don't know. It's basically like just some, you know, it's just like training your mind for programming problems. So I'm not sure if it's very useful for stuff outside of programming. Yeah, how to start CP? Jeevan, I'll take that question in a bit. I have slides on it. Yeah, CP related opportunities in ITB, I'll go over that. Yeah, okay, so from all of the other questions, I see that these are questions that I'm going to cover anyway. So if there are any more questions, you know, you can take them again at the end, if there's anything left over. So all right, I'm going to give you guys one last problem, and I'll give the solution at the end of the presentation. So unless somebody gets it. So yeah, this one is actually pretty nice. You guys have all the knowledge required to solve this problem, but still I've seen like really, really good people who are good at math. They'll solve this one. So it's very interesting. So yeah, the question is this. Often competitive programming has interactive problems where, you know, the judge gives you some, you give the judge gives you back some number and stuff like that until you get to an answer. So this is one of those kind of problems. I think someone's unmuted. Can you mute yourself? Thanks. So yeah, the question is this. I just thought of a polynomial, and I'm guaranteeing you that every coefficient of the polynomial I thought of is positive. And the question is that you need to find the polynomial that I thought of in two moves. In a single move, you can ask me the value of my polynomial at some point C. And of course, you're not given anything about this polynomial. You're not given the degree or not given anything. So this is a very interesting question, and I'd like to see how you guys solve it. So note that no coefficient can be zero either. What I mean by positive is that no coefficient is zero as well. So for example, to make you guys understand what the queries are, consider this polynomial. Say I had this polynomial in my mind, 1 plus 4x plus 5x squared plus 7x cubed. And you would ask me, you know, what is the value of this polynomial at zero? I would tell you it's 1. Then you would ask me, what is its value at minus 1? I would tell you that it's minus 5. And at that point, you have to guess my polynomial and get it correct. So yeah, that is the question. Are there any doubts about the question? But here the x raised to 4 is 0. Yeah,
degree of the polynomial?
You don't know the degree of the polynomial. Degree of x raised to 4 is 0 because the polynomial is, you know, only up to degree x raised to 3. So all of...
wanted to ask that coefficient of x power 4 is 0, not degree.
Right, coefficient is 0, yeah.
But it is mentioned that no coefficient can be 0.
Yeah, I mean, so if it's a polynomial of degree 3, what I'm trying to say is that, you know, everything up to degree 3 has positive coefficients.
So are we given the degree?
you are not given the degree. I'm not telling you the degree at all. I'm not giving you this information. But it is true. It is just true. That's what you have to assume.
Okay.
So for example, say I thought of a polynomial of degree 5, and you know, I'll basically make everything up to degree 5 with positive coefficients. I'm not telling you the degree, but you have to guess the polynomial. Yeah, I sounds impossible, but it is possible.
Okay.
Are all coefficients integers? Yeah, you can assume that they're integers. They're positive, by the way. So they're positive integers in specific. Is there any constraint in the degree? There is no constraint in the degree. Yeah. Repeat the rating we should target. I would say around 1600 is like a good rating to target. Yeah, P of 0 not equal to 0 is true, Utkarsh. I mean, if P of 0 is 0, then you directly know. Yeah, I mean, P of 0 is not equal to 0. You can assume that. Is there any constraint on C? There is no constraint on C. You can ask me at any point. All right, so you guys can think about it. Yeah. This. Niyati, yeah, do you have a question? 1600 watt platform, yeah. So I was talking about code forces rating. That is like the standard that I use. Positive reals or integers. You can assume positive integers, Pranava. Are all coefficients single digit now? They can be huge. They can be really big. There are no... Yeah, if you have a question, you can speak up right now. Like, I'm not... looking at real stands. You can just unmute yourself and speak. Coefficients have no upper limit, no. So, yeah. Is there any more doubts on the question? You have no other information other than, you know, up to the degree the coefficients are positive. That's it. That's all you have. You have to answer me in two queries. One thing I will clarify is that, you know, you can ask the first query, get my answer, and then ask the second query. So, you know, it's not that you have to ask two queries simultaneously. Can 3.5 be accepted as a coefficient? No, I won't keep 3.5. I'll keep a positive integer. To be fair, that doesn't change my solution, but it's fine. Yeah. It should be a positive integer. You're right. Actually. All right. So I'll look at the solutions later. You can think about it and, I just glanced at some of the solutions people were trying to say, and yeah, none of you really has the correct idea so far, I think. So yeah, we'll come back to it at the end. You can think about it. All right. So people were asking, you know, how to do competitive programming. So, you know, these are the steps that roughly I think you should follow. First is you should understand the basics of writing a program. So if you're doing CS101, that's sufficient. So the basic things you need to understand is, you know, what is an array, what is a pointer, etc., how to write for loops, while loops, stuff like that. Then you start practicing basic implementation problems on a competitive programming website. I'll give you the names a bit later in the presentation, but see, what you should do is you go to that website, you go to the problem set, and then you sort by the most solved problems and start solving from there. So, you know, everyone starts from there. Everyone starts from somewhere, and it's the best place to start, because if it's the most solved, that means it's one of the easiest problems and it's a good place to start. I've also started like in the same way. Okay. The third thing is to understand what complexity analysis is. So, you know, what is space complexity? What is time complexity? So I won't explain what it is. You should go and look it up. I'll give you also books to read about it, but the idea is that you kind of do a pen paper calculation of how much memory and time your program will take, so that, you know, you have some sense of whether it's taking too much memory or too much time or not too much. Yeah, you should understand complexity analysis. Here is where the main learning is. You should learn the various data structures and standard template library in your favorite language. I would say it's preferred C++. I'll talk about language a bit later. So standard template libraries, stuff like map, vector, set, list, etc. A list for Python. But so this is where, you know, you start really using features of your specific programming language. You should definitely learn this. I think that they will teach you this in like the end of CS 101 or you can learn it on your own. It's not really that hard. I'll give you resources for this as well. After the basic implementations, you start studying algorithms and data structures and continue solving problems. As I said, you know, most solved go to most solved to least solved and stuff like that. Then you start taking part in weekly contests and track your progress. You can, of course, do that. Start doing this at any step. Yeah, so basically the idea is that weekly contests help you keep some track of your progress. Don't take them too seriously. As you know, if you go down, don't start, you know, getting depressed or anything. It happens. But I can guarantee you that over, you know, like a month or 2 months, you will see like a significant improvement if you continue to practice regularly. All right. So which programming language to use? I would say for competitive programming, strongly prefer C++. So here are the advantages. C++ is fast and efficient. I've already learned it in CS101. There are lots of templates and pre-written code available for, you know, algorithms in C++. You won't get this a lot with other languages. And the most important thing, most time limits are set with respect to C++. So you might get time limit exceeded if you're using other languages. So I have been like a problem author on multiple websites. What I've observed is that, you know, most authors won't write solutions to alternate languages at all. And sometimes it's not even possible because we don't know that many languages ourselves and we don't have the time to, you know, implement all of them. So alternatively, you can use Java, Python and Kotlin. These are relatively safe. I would still say prefer C++ because it's much faster and you'll get much more pre-written code. But you can use these if you have like a strong inclination. And if you really want to be ridiculous and, you know, use something that nobody else uses, use something like OCaml, JavaScript, Delphi. Any language basically, yeah, almost. So yeah, where do I write and how do I check my code? So I'll be talking mostly about C++. Here is a list, thanks to Siddhartha Srivastava, who gave me the slide. So I personally use Sublime Text on Ubuntu. I definitely prefer it, it's quite good. So you can use that if you want. Many of you may use online IDEs, which basically means that you don't have it on your laptop, but you know, you go to some website online and then you compile your program there. So I would advise against it. This is what I used to do when I was a beginner. I used to write on CodeSafe's IDE, but it's slower than offline IDEs. You might want to eventually move to offline IDEs. So yeah, and especially if you guys are using like stuff like IDE1, so you need to make sure that your code is private, because by default it's public. And if someone, you know, sees your solution on there and copies it, then it will be like called as plagiarism and you will lose rating. So don't use stuff like IDE1. Just set up your own IDE. It won't take you more than a day, or you can ask for help from someone, from WNCC or something. And yeah, just get it set up. It's just a one-time job for things that you continue to do.
Can I ask something?
Yeah.
In the polynomial question which you just gave.
Yeah.
Can I just try a solution?
Yeah, sure.
Stone tree. Please give us some time.
It will be better. Okay. I will DM you. Okay, that's will be better, no?
I mean, it's fine. You can read about it. You can like post. Post it. You can like write it down and then post it at the end. So I'll read it.
Sure. Okay.
Yeah. So let people try to solve it because it's an interesting question.
Yeah.
I think that some of you may have got it by this time, but yeah, it's a very interesting question. Okay. So let me continue with the presentation. Does anybody have any other questions? I can just. No, I love VS Code. Yeah. Sure. Like. You can do whatever you want. Can unrestricted Sublime Text be used forever? Yes, you'll just get some ads. But I mean, for me, I didn't really find it that annoying. Is VS Code better? It won't increase your rating or anything, but if you like the interface better, it's good, I guess. What is the question? Aditya, there was a polynomial question. I'll come back to it at the end, so don't need to worry about it. It's not related to like the actual content. Sublime Text and IDE. I mean, it's just like a text editor. You compile and stuff on your console. So it's not really, it doesn't really debug and stuff. I think people do that, but yeah, I'm not really that aware. You can check it out online. You can check out these links that will be on this presentation that I'll share with you. Yeah, again, Siddhartha has made the slide for like a presentation in an IIT case, so I haven't really cross-checked it again. So you can check this out. He knows a lot more about it than me anyways. So yeah, I don't use Sublime Text as an IDE. What I do is I open Sublime Text, I code, I have pre-written templates and snippets in Sublime Text. So, you know, I have some template of problems that I always write, and I just, you know, enter a keyboard shortcut, my template opens, I write the code to the problem, and I compile on command line, and then that's it. So I don't really use it as an IDE, I guess. Which programming sites to practice on, right? So this is a question that a lot of you were asking. So yeah, I want to clarify, this is my personal preference list in terms of quality problems. So I'll tell you why each one of them is good and what it is good for, so that you can kind of understand which one to practice on according to your requirement. So CodeForces, in my opinion, is right now like the number one site. It has all kinds of quality problems. And the second thing is it has a lot of top competitors. So, you know, it's the best place to measure where you are at with respect to the best. And also the amount of blogs and educational stuff there, crazy. So you'll learn a lot by being on CodeForces. AdCoder is also, like, I don't know how to rank it with CodeForces, but it is very good. It has many, you know, mathy problems and ad hoc problems. What we mean by ad hoc is which doesn't really fit into, you know, an algorithm or a data structure. So like the problem that I just gave you, the odd even one, it's an ad hoc problem. It doesn't really involve something that you must have known before. It's an observation that you need to come up with. So AdCoder has many of these kind of problems, and it has a lower amount of coding component. So it is more about the observations than about the actual coding a lot. CodeChef, generally, like especially some of the harder problems on CodeChef will be like, the idea will not be that hard, but the coding part will be like significantly lengthy. So I remember problems that, you know, are like significantly higher on the div1, and there are just some direct applications of a surface structure or something. So, but they're a lot longer to code. So if you're trying to learn new data structures and algorithms, then CodeChef is a good place. And it will also help you get used to coding these things. So a lot of my friends have learned things for the first time doing CodeChef. Yeah, but it's when you're trying to practice these observation type questions, then AdCoder is better for you. USACO. Yeah, USACO is like very less known. It has very good problems. USACO is basically USA Computing Olympiad. So it's their like kind of high school Olympiad, but it has extremely good problems. They will definitely be challenging for like even the top programmers in the world. Some of the problems. Contests are held 4 times a year. You can look at the problems. They're very good, I would say, for practicing your implementation skills. So they also have very hard implementations. And yeah, so you can try that. CS Academy was also one of my favorite sites, but right now it's dead in the sense that there are no more contests being held on it. Still, you can go back and solve the problems. They're good problems. HackerRank. I don't have much of an opinion on HackerRank. Right now, as far as I'm aware, it has almost no contests. The old problems are nice, but I think that, you know, there are other better places like CodeForces, AdCoder, USACO. So yeah. TopCoder, I would not recommend it for beginners. It has many, you know, sometimes standard or boring problems. Some problems are good, but the interface is really bad, and the contest system is not that beginner friendly at all. So it has basically no pretests. And what I mean by pretests is when you submit code during the contest, then your code gets run against a set of preliminary tests called pretests. And if your code passes that, then it will later be run on system tests, which is like a full set of tests. So your code needs to pass both the pretests and the system tests to be considered successful. in Top Coder, there are basically no pretests. So only after the end of the contest will you come to know whether your code was successful or not. So it's kind of like coding blind, and therefore I don't recommend it. It's good if you like want to practice, you know, writing code without a single mistake. So because you won't get any feedback till the end of the contest. So yeah, but I still don't suggest it a lot. HackerEarth, I would say don't go for HackerEarth. Yeah, it has a very low quality bar in my opinion, and unless you want to give like it has like contests once in a month or something, or twice in a month, which have like cash prizes and t-shirts and stuff which you can get. It's achievable, so if you want to go for that, you can go for that, but otherwise I wouldn't say it's good for improvement in that sense. LeetCode, right? So I have never done LeetCode actually, so I asked one of my friends who is currently, I think, the highest rated Indian on LeetCode to give an opinion on this. And what he's told me basically was that it's very good for preparing for placements and internships. So it's the best, because what happens is that a lot of these problems are usually the problems that come exactly as interview problems. So if you're preparing for placements and internships, and if you're like, you know, in your third year or something, then you should just do LeetCode. Otherwise, like, you can do some amount of Codeforces and stuff like that, and then move on to LeetCode as your interviews are getting closer. So, you know, they'll give you exactly the kind of questions that come in placements and interviews. So how is Coded Dojo and stuff like that? I don't know a lot of these sites. How is Project Euler? Project Euler also, I don't really have much of an opinion. I don't think it's exactly a CP site. It's more about getting good at math, relatively. I will upload these slides, so don't worry about it. How is Code Wars? I won't suggest Code Wars. I did it like a few of it before, but it's not good for your improvement, right? So somebody asked me what you would suggest for beginners. I will just answer that in one go. I would suggest focus on Codeforces. You should do the Div 2s and Div 3s. And the educational rounds, definitely. AdCoder, you should do the AdCoder ABCs. CodeChef, do the CodeChef long challenge. It is like a 10-day long thing. So you will like learn to have that perseverance and keep trying on a problem and, you know, Googling stuff, trying to get closer and closer to what could be the solution to the problem. Googling and all is, by the way, allowed in programming contests. So, you know, you feel free to Google, and because basically the problems are not meant to be new, so, you know, they shouldn't be found anywhere. So CodeChef Long Challenge helps you to spend 10 days and try to keep, you know, hitting your head on what the problem could be, etc., etc. So it's very good for training your perseverance in doing hard problems. So I would recommend these three above all: Codeforces, AdCoder, CodeChef. Try to do these at least. All right. So let me move on. Yeah, so someone started talking about Top Coder Open, so I'll cover that, don't worry. Which programming contests should I do, and which are the top programming contests today? So there are a variety of major programming contests that I like or I recommend people to participate in. So these include ICPC. I will talk about ICPC more in depth. I know a lot of you want like ask questions about it. So yeah, just keep that in mind. Then Google Code Jam. Google Code Jam is like a contest organized by Google, which is one person, and ours are variable, I think. But you should do Google Code Jam. It's like Google Code Jam and Facebook Hacker Cup are the same kind of things. It's very doable to get a t-shirt from these contests and stuff. So it's like really fun as well, and it also adds a point in your resume. So that's there. Google Hashcode. It's not exactly a competitive programming contest, but it's very similar. It's a four-person contest, 4 hours, and you get approximation problems, which is not like solving exactly, but you need to keep getting a better and better solution, getting closer to the optimal score. All of you can like see this and register for this, because it's in February this year. So you can register until February 22 or something. So yeah, you can participate in this. Quora programming contest. I haven't participated the last time. It was in 2014 last time. So Yeah, it is returning this year and it's happening on February 6th or 7th, so take part in that. Yeah, somebody talked about Top Coder Open and Top Coder Collegiate Contest. So, I am not fully aware of the rules, but I think for Top Coder Open, you need to participate from January to March in the SRMs or that Top Coder holds. This is basically the contest that Top Coder holds. And your points will be added and then they'll give you invites for Top Coder Open and TCC. So yeah, you can check out more about this online. This is basically the only reason I personally do Top Coder, to be honest. Right now, the only reason I started doing Top Coder like last week is because of TCM. Apart from that, I don't really make. Yeah, somebody was asking about college stuff and I mean about teams basically. So yeah, teams have to be made on your own. Like there is really no involvement from the college side. Yeah, what about HackerRank? Yeah, I mean, the same thing. I don't really have like a lot of opinions. There are better, I think that there are better things you can do. Can beginners take part in this contest or should we wait until the finish of first time? I don't think you need to wait. Like, you can start in your first time, definitely. You will start getting some exposure. Yeah, there is no real reason to wait. How much math will you suggest we need? I will come to like specific topics later. Yeah, I mean, the order is a bit inverted, but I'll just follow this order for now. All right, so let's come to the major programming contest that all of you want to talk about, ICPC, which is the Intercolleges Programming Contest. When will it happen? This year, the dates are uncertain, but it will probably happen from what I've been like talking to people about. And yeah, please, a lot of you keep asking, you know, when it will happen, will it happen? Don't worry, like when it will happen, CodeChef will post it on its site. They themselves don't know right now because they don't have the information from what I talked to them about. So usually the timeline in a normal year is registration of teams opens August to September. Online round happens in the mid of October. Regional rounds happen in the month of December. So there are like regional rounds. I'll talk about that. And then there is a super regional, which is basically the top teams of the regionals are invited to a super regional, which is called the Asia West Championship, which happens in mid-January. And then the world finals happens anywhere between March to June. All right. So the idea is this. The online round that happens is a first filtering process that consists of 5 to 8 problems that are to be solved by a team of 3 people in 3 hours. Right, so ICPC is a 3-person contest. You make your own team and then solve these problems. So online round has 5 to 8 problems. Based on these online round standings, you will or will not be invited to different regionals. There are 4 regionals and I'll talk more about that if there are questions on it. But yeah, so you can choose any of the 4. You can choose 2 of the 4 and you can go to 2 of the 4 at max. How to qualify to regionals? So around top 15 to 20 teams of IITB qualify to some regional, depending on the quota. Some regionals will only take like, you know, 1 or 2 teams from an institute. Whereas Amrita Puri, which is like a regional which is totally merit-based, will take top 300 teams merit-based. Right? The other regionals will kind of one team per college. So because basically only one team per college can go to the world finals. So you can't like have 5 teams from the same college going to world finals. Therefore, they just import it directly at the regional stage. Regional rounds are usually 14 problems and a 5-hour contest. And the same format, 10 to 14 problems, 5-hour contest is followed for Asia West and world finals as well. So are there any questions? I think there are seniors, Prajwal. So, okay. Apart from that, are there any other questions? Don't we need a mentor for ICPC? You need a professor to register you. So, like, I think professors in the CS department are quite open to, you know, register people who ask them, especially if you have studied from some professors. So, you just ask them and you can talk to your seniors about it, like immediate seniors about it, or WNCC people. So, they can help you maybe find some prof. Apart from that, any other questions about ICPC so far? All right. So I remember somebody asking how IITB does it ICPC. So I like did a bit of research and I came up with the past like 8 years data. And all right, so let me first make you understand how the world finals system is. So the top team is the ICPC world champion. The second to fourth teams get a gold medal. The fifth to eighth teams get a silver medal. The ninth to 12th teams get a bronze medal. Then 13 to 70, I'm not sure of the exact number, but usually 13 to 70 around get a rank. And if you're beyond rank 70, then you get an honorable mention. And if you are like, if you get zero problems, then you get nothing. So, yeah. So I just want to explain that IITB and in general, India has not been doing that well at the world finals. At least at the world stage. So in 2013, I'm not sure which team took part. I couldn't find the name, but the rest of the teams I found in, and you know, these are all strong teams that have done extremely well at the regionals and gone to the world finals. And this is true for India as a whole. Like almost every Indian team does not do well at the world finals. Our best teams usually, so as far as I remember, Team Rocket was the best team in its year, which got a world rank of 34 from India. So best Indian teams usually get a rank of 40 or something. And there is the best team ever achieved by an Indian team is rank 18 in 2012, if I remember correctly. So that means that no Indian team has ever won a medal, which is kind of sad. And therefore, I hope that, you know, you guys can take IITB to new highs. Someday IITB will win the first medal for India. In 2020, my team Bhagwan Bharose is going to the world finals. The finals have been postponed, so they're in June 2021. And another reason I'm telling you guys to not worry about the next ICPC is because the next ICPC world finals, which is for 2021, is being held in March 2022, from what I understand. So, there is a significant amount of time for the regionals to happen yet. The schedule is a bit messed up, but I think it will happen. All right. So what do you study for ICPC? So here is a rough list of things that you need to have. You need to know. Standard template library is the first, as I explained before. Then, you know, stuff like binary search, journey research. I guess many of you already know about what binary search is. Sorting algorithms. Next is writing brute force algorithms. What that means is, you know, you're given an idea, just write it into code into the most brute force way possible. So for example, I gave you that problem where you have to change every matrix cell by one or not. What you can do is you can just basically try every possible move that you can make and then check whether that works. So yeah, that complexity, the time it will take will be huge, but you can do that in theory. Backtracking, pruning. What pruning means is basically reducing the runtime by removing things which will never be useful and stuff like that. Greedy algorithms, dynamic programming, graph algorithms. What kind of mathematics do you need? Right, so mathematics is like really a big part of these contests. I would say you don't need a lot of background to start competitive programming. Since you guys have already done JEE Advanced and stuff and come here, I'm sure that all of you have enough background to start doing CP. It's only when you start getting to, you know, a higher level where you need to learn more and more. So even for me, it happens to everyone. You will reach a point where you need to start learning more math just to keep up with it. But that point is quite far right now. You won't require it until maybe 1700 or 1900 in terms of code versus rating. So yeah, there is a way to go for that. String algorithms, such as KMP, Z-Algo, etc. And then you have like other advanced algos, such as flow, suffix structures, and stuff like that. So one thing that I've noticed is that people start going for advanced algos really quickly. And it's a good thing that you're learning advanced algos, but make sure to keep practicing a lot of observation and ad hoc and etc. problems. Because from what I've noticed personally in ICPC, a lot of the advanced stuff that I've read or my team knows about has like never come in use during an actual ICPC contest. It comes in use during online contests, sure. So for ICPC contests that are being held, the most important thing is honing your observation and thinking skills rather than learning a ton of algorithms and not doing any problems about it. So you learn an algorithm, you do a lot of problems about it, and you like do hard problems on them as well, which force you to think and come up with, you know, novel ways to use that algorithm. Learning advanced algos is good. You should learn it side by side while continuing other practice. Where do we learn all this from? Right, coming up on the next slide. So the top website that I recommend for you to get your templates for programming in C++ is CP Algorithms. I'll give you the slides. You can get this link. No need to type it out right now. But CP Algorithms basically has a list of a lot of common algorithms that are being used and how you program them and stuff like that. So I recommend it. A Competitive Programmer's Handbook, in my opinion, is a very good book for a beginner. It's by Antti Laaksonen. And by the way, this book is available online for free by the author itself. So the author himself has put the book online. And therefore, I would recommend that you get this book and you start studying it thoroughly. It has all of, it has like at least, you know, apart from the other advanced algos part, it has everything else that you need to learn. And I learned everything from this book personally starting out. Competitive Programming 4, CP4 by Stephen Halim is also a very good book that you can follow. For me, it was a bit more confusing. I preferred Competitive Programmer's Handbook, but friends have done the opposite. So you can use either of them. Right. So there is this CodeForces blog that has a list of all useful tutorials on CodeForces. So what happens is that, you know, competitive programming is a very fast moving field and things get outdated, like in the sense that, you know, there are a lot more algorithms that come up daily. I'm not daily, but yearly at least. There are things that we discover. For example, like I think 2 years back, we discovered segment tree beats, which is, which is like completely new thing to, was a new thing to me and a lot of programmers. So, it's a very rapidly moving field. We keep learning new things. So some of these things can't be found in books. People write tutorials about them on CodeForces. So this blog entry that I'm giving you has a list of, almost all of these useful tutorials. And you can use these to study topics that you might not find in books. Or if you think that the book's explanations are too, like you can't understand it, then there might be a tutorial about it. Probably there is. So you can look at this blog. Then you have Introduction to Algorithms by CLRS, which is a standard textbook that people use while studying data structures and algorithms. The reason why I haven't recommended this above the others is that, it actually tries to teach you a lot about the proofs and stuff like that. So it might be a bit boring and long, whereas the other two like focus more on competitive programming and will kind of give you more tips as to how to get into coding them and coding them correctly and stuff like that. So yeah, it will help you more to understand how to implement it from programming perspective. All right. So yeah, so we can talk about this problem again and then I'll take some questions. I'll take some questions after this. So yeah, some people had the solution. You can go ahead.
Okay, so first I'll ask for P of 1 and store it as say A. Then I'll whatever number A is, I'll ask for P of A.
Yeah.
And let's say store it in B for a temporary variable. I'll take right. B mod A. That will be the constant term. Then I'll subtract A and divide by, I'll subtract the constant term and divide by A. Then I'll get the second term and I'll iterate like that.
Right. Yeah. So that's your Shubh, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Shubh. Yeah. So that's exactly the correct idea. I think other people might have also gotten the idea. I'm not sure, but yeah. So that's great that you guys solved it actually. Let me just explain it so that everyone understands it once. So the idea of this problem is that you crucially use that the coefficient of this polynomial is positive. First, you query the value of this polynomial at 1. So this is the summation of the coefficients of the polynomial. So for example, at 1, I'll get 17. Now I query this polynomial at 17. Then I will get some number which is uniquely expressed in base 17. Like I know literally every coefficient of the polynomial now. There is just one special case that you need to take care of when you know, you just have a constant polynomial, then you will get like something like 17 into 1, but that's not like x, that's 17 instead. That's a constant polynomial. Just make sure of that. But yeah. Does anybody have questions as to the solution? If it's confusing, you can let me know. I can go through it again.
Can you please explain it once more?
Yeah, sure.
What is the issue with constant polynomial?
Right, I let me just explain the whole solution once more. So the idea is that you know, query p of 1. So what this will give you is the sum of all coefficients. You agree with this, right? Okay, so it will give you some sum of all the coefficients, say 17.
Yes.
What I want to do is, okay, let me do actually an easier solution than this even. So do you agree that 17 will be at least the degree of the polynomial? I mean, whatever P of 1 comes out to be will be at least the degree of the polynomial.
It should be 16, degree should be 16.
Yeah, I mean, sorry, yeah. I mean, it will be at least the degree. That's what I'm saying. Like, it will be more than the degree.
Yes.
Yeah. So, what you can do is you can, like, yeah, actually, like, I think, basically, what you can do is you can choose, like, 10 raised to 17 or some huge number. So, what you do is you choose such a huge number that all of these coefficients kind of spaced out. So for example, if I choose 10, then this will become 1, 4, 5, 7. Right. So it will become like 7.
Hello?
5, 4. Yeah.
You can choose the next largest, like just larger value of power of 10.
Yeah, you can. Yeah. In this case, yeah, I'm giving like basically two solutions over here. What I'm trying to explain to you is that suppose if I put like x equal to 10 over here, then it becomes 7, 5, 4, 1, and I found the polynomial, but 10 is like too small to make sure that, because I don't know the coefficients. I want to choose a value that for sure will separate out all of these, like, so that this doesn't interfere with this term. So I'll choose x as some like 10 raised to 17, 10 raised to sum of all the coefficients. And this will, so I'll make sure that this term and this term are definitely separated. Then I can just, you know, figure out the terms by reverse analysis. Or otherwise, if you have like learned how, so for example, if you know how to express a number in another base. So for example, if you're trying to express a number in base 17, then this is how you would express it. 1 plus 4 into 17 plus 5 into 17 square plus 7 into 17 cube. So this is basically the same idea as doing it in tens, right? So when you're expressing a number, say 21, then you write it as 2 into 10 plus 1 into 1. Correct. I'm doing the same thing, but with 17. And you know that it's uniquely representable when you're doing it with 10. I'm just doing the same thing with 17. So I'm telling you. Yeah.
Hello.
If yeah, the coefficients are greater than 17.
It can't be greater than 17, right? Because P of 1 is the sum of all positive coefficients. So that is the crucial part of the problem, actually.
Okay.
That all of the coefficients are positive and their sum is something. So coefficients can't be greater than 17. Now is it clear?
I have a doubt.
Yes. Yeah.
Why you have assumed that polynomial is of degree
3? I'm not assuming this. I'm just trying to give you an example. This is just an, like...
So there will be many polynomials between 1 to 17.
Yeah, yeah. There will be many polynomials.
Okay.
Yeah, what I'm just telling you is, first, this is the solution. This is just the explanation part. So, you know, if there is 17, then you'll have 17 raised to 17 or something. Right.
Okay, from this method we can find one of them. Am I right?
No, not one of them. You can find it uniquely. That's what I'm telling you. There will be only one polynomial of this type.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, because once you query this, then what I'm telling you is that the answer like gives you the polynomial uniquely. So yeah, I mean it's a bit of a hard problem. You should go back and like read this again if it's a bit confusing. Yeah. Okay.
So, hello.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what you did in the earlier solution, 10 to the power sum of all the coefficients and the other solution, like expressing it in some number which is greater than the sum of coefficients, those are essentially the same, right? I mean,
yeah, 10 to the power is just easier to like kind of
okay.
Yeah. Solutions are the same.
Hello, I just wanted to mention that wouldn't it be best to take p of 1 plus 1 because
yeah
p was you're a right. constant polynomial, then it would be a small issue, right?
Yeah, that's why I said like about the constant polynomial. P of 1 plus 1 is the best, but I didn't want to like...
But what's the problem on case of constant?
For constant, it's that... So what I said was, you want to express it in base of P of 1, right? But if you're expressing a constant polynomial, so for example, for the polynomial that I gave you, if it was just, say, 17, then P of 1 would also be 17. And you would think that it's 17 into 1. So it's like 0 plus 1 into 17, which is wrong.
Like, but the condition of question was telling that no coefficient.
Yeah, exactly. That's why you kind of can figure out that it's 1 into 17. So that's a special case, right?
Yeah.
Like, it turns out to be 17.
I mean, it works, but we need to think about it.
The problem is that, like, I mean, when you're expressing a number in like base 17, then all the coefficients should be less than 17.
Yeah. Okay.
But in that case, the coefficient itself is becoming 17.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
I have a doubt.
Yeah.
The doubt is that if the you had said before that if the coefficients are not integers, then also the same process will work.
Yeah, that's what I said. Yeah, that I
don't think so.
You're right. Yeah. It won't work. You're right.
Yeah. Exactly. Because the remainder won't come. The remainder has to be integer or the positive. Right. Yeah.
Okay.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
I don't think there is any problem with picking 17, even if it is a constant polynomial. Since if P1 is P of 1, then it directly implies that the polynomial is constant. Since if it is non-constant, then it will have to be an increasing function.
Right. Yes. You're right. You can still do it. I mean, it's just like we're just explaining that could be like a case where your code fails.
Achha, code can fail. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
You need to make sure to, you know, analyze these cases when you're writing the code for this problem.
We can also do that. In that case, they are arguing that the sum of the coefficient, which is P of 1 is, we are using it to take the mod.
Yeah.
Instead of that, we can simply take some any number which is greater than 17. Now, that's best.
Yeah, we can do that. We can do that also. That's why someone suggested P of 1 plus 1 and that works. Yeah.
Yeah. Any greater than. Yeah.
I just wanted to point out that, you know, suppose if you get... this could be like a contest problem and you guys have the correct idea that you have to use P of 1, then you need to make sure that your code won't fail, and this is some place where your code can fail. So all right, next step, how to evaluate polynomials. So are these kind of problems are hard-coded? Yes. So like Artcoder has a lot of creative problems and it's extremely fun. It can get a bit frustrating as well. It makes you feel stupid. It makes me feel stupid. So because the solutions are so like elegant and you kind of don't get it even after trying for 2 hours. So it's extremely fun. You should try it out, definitely. All right. Okay, are there any other questions, by the way? Like, I think I can take questions now. It's fine, Vanid. It's just starting. You'll get used to it. I mean, you won't get used to being stupid. I'm saying that you'll get much better at it by practice. How is Spodge? Right. Yeah. People were asking me about Spodge. So, I would say that Spodge also sometimes has a quality issue, but it's good for testing out your implementations. So, say if you've written some implementation for some problem, then for example, you know, if you've written some centroid decomposition, then there will be some problem on Spodge that asks you to exactly do that thing, and you can test your implementation of the algorithm on that. So that's the thing that I use Spodge for. Other than that, I don't really use Spodge. Okay.
Shivambhai, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yeah, okay. So my question is that I am an intermediate in competitive programming right now. So like I have 3 stars on CodeShare. So I know this is for beginners, but I also wanted to know that there are few intermediate CP also there. But so I wanted to ask how do you get from intermediate to advanced? You know, you have 1600, 1700 code forces. How do you get like to up there? And, you know, so intermediate to advanced, how do you get to that in CP? That's my question.
I would say that roughly it's the same up to 2100. So same range. So basically what you have to do is until like maybe 1900, you need to, if you're giving code forces, then you need to start solving like div2d and div2e. You need to start solving them. Don't try to solve, you know, like div1ds and stuff like that. I know people do that. That is way out of your reach currently. Try to solve the problems which you're not able to solve in contest, the next two problems regularly, a lot of them. And that is the main thing I would say, like in terms of practice. And once you like go to around 1900, then you should start giving div1 rounds more, so that you can get used to, you know, starting at a high difficulty at the very start. Don't do like, stop doing easy problems. That's what I'm telling you basically. Like, don't waste your time on easy problems, relatively.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So what did you do from all of the books and references you mentioned in the first year? I didn't actually start in my first year. I started in my summer of my second year. So definitely you guys have a lot of time. And I personally, in the summer of my second year, I did, I did Competitive Programmer's Handbook by Antti Laaksonen. Almost like, I guess a majority of it, above 80%, and a bit of CP4. And the CP algorithms was just, I just always like constantly use it. I even use it today. So look up if I like don't remember how some problem was implemented. I'm a 40. All right. Are there any other questions? Let me see. Okay, yeah, so Prajwal had like an interesting question. If Amrita Puri has more seats, then why would anyone register through any other region? Is there any advantage of joining through other regions? Right, so there are 4 regions, right, Prajwal? So you need to register for 2. So Amrita Puri, like generally, I recommend everyone doing like Amrita Puri, and my team also does Amrita Puri every year. And we do one other region apart from that. So, the only teams that I know of that don't choose Amrita Puri at all are teams that, you know, are like either clearly the strongest in their college. So it's advantageous for them not to go to Amrita Puri because there is less competition. I mean, Amrita Puri has a lot more competition because it's completely merit based. So you have like, they get lesser competition by going to some other region, twice. Or teams that have, you know, made like, there are only two teams in the college and they've made like a deal among themselves that you go for these two, I'll go for these two. So, yeah, apart from that, there is no reason that you shouldn't go to Amritapuri. It is very good. What is Amritapuri? Good question. ICPC regionals are held at four sites. Kanpur, Kharagpur, Amritapuri, and Pune Gwalior. So these are the four regionals. Basically, you have to choose two of them. Is there a limit on how many ICPCs we can participate in? I think it's five. 5 years. So anyways, like you will cross your age limit around MTech first year. So I mean, in your fifth year. So it won't be an issue for you guys. You'll basically cross your age limit. What is Amritapuri? I didn't get anything from switching online. Okay, let me just share the link. This is the ICPC 2020. And so is this your first year in ICPC or have you participated before? So the first time I participated in ICPC was in second year. Like, as I told you guys, I started in like May of my second year. And in December of my second year, we came 24th, I think, in Amritapuri. And we didn't get to qualify to the other regional because there was like some team from our college that was above us. So it's definitely 100% possible to like get a good result. And in my third year, we came first at Amritapuri and third at Kanpur. So we made world finals. In my fourth year, of course, ICPC hasn't happened yet. What are the best sites? Akshat, you can refer to the slides that I'll put up. We've already discussed that a bit. Or you can look at the recording as well. Yeah, at coderesult.jp, yes, of course. Gaurav, resources for mathematics which are required for beginners. I would like recommend you to go through Competitive Programmer's handbook once. And if you feel that is not enough, you should go through the Codeforces blog post where you have a list of all tutorials. Usually there are very good mathematics tutorials because a lot of people struggle with that. If it's still like not clear for some specific topic after looking at both of these sites, then you can post again. But I would definitely like recommend everyone to go through Competitive Programmer's handbook first. Khatam ho gaya kya? Yeah, I mean, it's almost over, I guess. I'm just like taking final questions now. All right. So I guess that's it, guys. I just have some final memes for you before we end. So let me just share those. The right thing is something that I've experienced more times than I would like ever hope of. All right. This is something that will happen to you guys. Don't worry. You may laugh now, but you won't be laughing later. Yes, and this is the unnamed thing. Everyone hates geometry because it's really, really, it's like, yeah, it requires a lot of skill to be able to manage geometry problems. Yeah, that's it from my side. What would you recommend to someone not good at coding but good at maths? I mean, I think that if your math is good, then it's like a very big advantage and you can start learning. Like, you can get into computer programming much faster. So I think if you're good at math already, you would enjoy alt coder problems a lot more. And you know, you just need to start practicing basic DSA and basic DSA. So, and also if you're going for ICPC, you can look at people who like coding more so that you can. So yeah, this is one thing that I would like to emphasize, that, you know, in ICPC, it's not just, you know, that everybody likes the same things. You need to choose a team that diversifies a bit. And you can, all of you should like different things. So for example, in my team, everyone was really strong at completely different areas, and that helps a lot. Because, you know, we see a problem, we see that, you know, this is right up your alleyway, why don't you try this problem while I try the other problem? So that is a big thing. So Tirthankar, if you like maths a lot, then you can maybe look for someone who likes to implement problems a lot. So that could also be a pretty cool thing. Olympiad geometry was fun. It wasn't fun for me at all, so thankfully it's not an SCPC. Yeah, I have heard that CP and the stuff we need for a job or something are different. Is that true? Abhiram, see, that is true, but basically what I'm recommending to you is that you use CP as a good way to get acquainted with like programming and data structures and algorithms, which are like kind of foundations before you do any like good software work. So yeah, it isn't exactly, I'm not telling you to do it and then you will become great at software programming. That's definitely not true, but it's a good way to get started with it. And to be honest, many companies use like CP problems in interviews or hiring tests, and therefore it just becomes like a great advantage if you know CP. So it helps you get into the company, and then of course you can start learning how to do a job. You should do other stuff as well within college. You should start doing projects, but it's just a good way to get your hands dirty and learning the language. Yeah. Practice. What to do when stuck on the problem for too long? Ashish tells you to practice. I agree with Ashish. I mean, personally, I see the solution after like 30 minutes. What people follow is that if you don't get any ideas at all, then you start looking at like the first two lines of the solution and then take the hint and then try to do it on your own again and stuff like that. So how did you participate in second year itself? Nirlavar, so I started in like May of my second year. I registered in August of my second year and then participated in October. So it's really not, I'm telling you guys that, I mean, I also should tell you that I used to do it like a lot. Like I used to love it a lot. So you guys should, if you guys want to participate, then you guys can do it also in like 2-3 months. It's not really an issue. It won't take that much time. Yeah. But do we just need to practice or also read theory? So Prajwal, it's like a very good balance of the two. You read theory and then you also know to, you have to implement that problem, because you know, I had this issue before. I know how you feel. I used to read a lot of theory, and when the problem used to come during a contest, I used to have a hard time implementing it. And like, I have a lot of solutions which I couldn't debug and get finished in time for the contest. So, you know, read it and then implement it yourself. Do it for a few problems, and only then you can be confident that you will be, you need to be confident that you'll be able to do it in like a contest setting. Right, Kostov is asking, do we have to make our own CPP file with snippets and definitions? If you guys want, you can like take my CPP file or anything, but they don't really help that much. That much I can tell you. See, Kostov, like top level participants, if you look at tourists and stuff, they use libraries mainly for things other than hashtag defines. They use it for like modular arithmetic and stuff. So, you know, adding modular wise, subtracting, dividing. So that they don't have to write mod every time. You don't really need it for yourself. I don't use the modular libraries myself. I use hashtag defines, but it's really not necessary. It's just something that has become a habit for me now. Omkar, you can look at the slides later. I've already put it in the slides. Tips for implementing, that's the place I am always stuck. Saurabh, I would say like start from the most solved problems on CodeForces. Maybe I can just put a link over here. But the basic idea is that everyone has to start from somewhere, and believe me, that's where I started from as well. So yeah. How to create use templates, let me write it down. Sublime. So you can make a snippet in Sublime, just look it, just Google it up, and then I just enter a keyboard shortcut and that code comes up. So, you know, I open my Sublime Text editor, I type in CF and my CF template comes up. Where will you upload the slides? I'll maybe upload it on Drive and post it here. I'll post it on this group or whatever. So on the Telegram as well. So if you're on the if you're not on the Telegram, you can join the Telegram. I'll post it there.
Yeah, we can also add it on Teams. So like, there's no issue with that.
Yeah, I mean, I think people from outside IITB aren't added to the Teams or something. I'm not sure. But
yeah, okay. So we'll also put it on Telegram.
Yeah. Okay. So, yeah. Sarthak, I mean, I don't want to answer like a lot of specific questions, but since there's just one question from Sarthak, we'll end after this. You can't really take modulus by a floating point number. You have to convert it to an integer. Will CP help me? It helps for programming jobs, I would say. I mean, if you want to ever go to like a programming job, software developer or anything like that, it'll help you. All right. Thanks, guys. So that's it, I think, from my side.
Thanks a lot, Bhaiya. That was really amazing to have you here with us.
Yeah, thanks, Bhaiya.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Bye. I'm signing off now.
All gold at ICPC.
Shubham.
Thank you.
Okay, one more announcement. Like, WNCC is planning for a competitive programming session. Like, not sort of session, but a competition mostly next weekend. You'll get informations on mail and on Facebook and Instagram posts. So do follow us on there and see you guys at the competition.
Yeah, sure.